In heaven. Do you know why God gave us this earthly life? For one reason, to prepare for eternal life. Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right, so, and now we'll listen to this beautiful song. Let's sing why sometimes in our eyes we have tears. It's because Satan is giving us bad time. But always, let's concentrate on Jesus.
Amen.
Мав ти коли, чому сльози течу з твоїх очей, коли так важко на душі, Бог потішає нас, Він чує плач в тиші, Бог розуміє. Сльози людей, Бог бачить сльози, всі печалі твої, Він бачить сльози і чує крик душі. Бог разом плаче. Співчуває він тобі, Бог розуміє сльози людей, Бог розуміє сльози людей. Спіткають нас в житті, надія гасне, слабне віра і любов. О, все Він проведе, і сльози нам утре, Бог розуміє. Сльози людей, Бог бачить сльози, всі печалі твої, Він бачить сльози і чує крик душі, Бог разом плаче. Співчуває він тобі, Бог розуміє сльози людей, Бог розуміє сльози людей.
Amen. Again, the words are God knows every tear. The spirit of prophecy says that not even one tear dropped down with God not knowing that it's happened. So, and if you're going through some difficult time, please remember that God is always with you. And the next song is, Jesus said, come to me, I have peace, I have plan, I have vision for you, I have joy, I have something very special for your life. Okay.
Редактор субтитров А.Семкин Корректор А.Егорова.
Everybody are saying, praise the Lord, hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. My friends, just one little information. Sacramento has 230,000 Russian-speaking people. Only in Sacramento we have more than 130 Russian churches. And it's different churches, of course, it's Baptist, Pentecostals, and some other churches. And we have our great big church with beautiful choir, this group and their choir, participating in a lot of missionary evangelistic programs around Sacramento. They helped in Fresno, your place, San Francisco, and different other places. Praise the Lord. Please pray for us. We'll pray for you. That will God unite us, that we will encourage each other to prepare this world for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Amen. This is our mission. God bless you, brothers and sisters. Amen. God bless.
Thank you, Alex.
Thank you. Now it's time for the children's story. All children, please come forward and look around.
Thank you.
Good morning, saints of the Campbell Church. You didn't know you were saints, did you? Well, the Bible means that saints are those that are dedicated to God. Paul, when he wrote his epistles to the various churches, he said, to the saints who were in Rome, to the saints that are in Corinth, to the saints that are in Ephesus. So as my good friend on the radio, J. Vernon McGee, used to say, you know, you're either a saint or you ain't. So I prefer to be a saint today. Welcome to the saints here in Campbell. Debbie and I are just delighted to be back with you again today. No matter where we may go on this earth, this will always be our home. For those of you that don't know us that well or have never met us, this is the church that I grew up in, not this building. It was at another location, and several of my good friends here were in the old church over on Rincon. We grew up in this church, and I had the privilege of pastoring this church for 13 years. This is where my parents obviously went to church, and my sister, who's in Loma Linda. This is where Debbie became a Seventh-day Adventist through evangelistic meetings, and where we were married. So this will always be our home church. And I'm also happy that our youngest son, John Edward, is with us today. We hadn't seen him until yesterday for a couple of months because he's been down the last 3 years in Argentina working on his nursing degree. And now he is working in San Francisco, taking care of sick people in their homes. So it's a real delight to be back with you here again this morning. As we begin our study, let's first of all look to God in prayer, shall we, and ask him to bless his word. Father in heaven, now we come to that part of the service where we want you to speak to us. We have been talking to you, and this is an opportunity now for you to speak to us through your word. So Lord, give us listening ears, give us open minds, receptive hearts. Help us to understand this very, very vital subject. And may we leave here with a renewed confidence and assurance in Jesus Christ is my prayer in his name. Amen. As we begin, would you take your Bible? We're going to be looking at a number of scriptures today. And we're going to turn, first of all, to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'll give you the verse in just a moment. We're going to be using our Bibles a lot today. I believe that when we come to church, we need to use the Word of God. Amen? And you may wish to jot down these references on a piece of paper or your bulletin, because some of these are going to be new to you. I guarantee it. And you will want to read these verses again. 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, and verse 10. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10. And this is what the Apostle Paul says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ." How many will appear before God in judgment? Everyone who has ever lived, right? Why? So that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or bad. Here we are told that our lives are going to be laid bare before God. And other texts of Scripture says that he will hold us accountable for everything that we've ever said, done, or thought. Now, if we were honest, most of us would have to admit that the idea of judgment scares us. For example, if you received a summons from the court, either in person by somebody knocking on your door in the mail, and say, you are required to be in court because you are being charged with a crime. Would you say, oh, happy day. This is the best day of my life. I'm really looking forward to that. Absolutely not. For most people, the idea of judgment scares them. In fact, I would venture to say today that not one of you could honestly say, I am looking forward to the day of judgment. It's interesting. That you were just talking about, you know, looking forward to Jesus and having the calendar and all of that. But to look forward to the judgment, probably not. And why not? Well, I'm sure most of you feel like I do that our lives are not everything that they should be. And so that's one reason we're not really looking forward to it. And for many people, maybe not you, but for Christians in general and certainly the world in general, they have this picture of God, that God is somehow like a celestial Sherlock Holmes that goes around with a huge magnifying glass just waiting to catch us doing something wrong. And so we think, how in the world can we ever pass muster when God is going to examine us that carefully, meticulously going over the books of record to see if we have perfectly measured up to his ideal for our lives. And then the teaching that Jesus is our intercessor, which is true, also tends to foster this idea of the fear of the judgment. Unwittingly, perhaps, we have somehow projected the notion that God the Father is not as merciful as Jesus Christ. And if it were not for Jesus pleading before the Father in our behalf, as if to say, Father, please don't be so hard on Ed and Aurora. I love them. Father, please go easy on them. You know, we have this idea, why is he pleading before the Father? Aren't they on the same team? And yet this picture of, you know, here's the Father back here, and Jesus is standing with his arm around the sinner, and he's pleading before God. Isn't that the image that many of us grew up with? Exactly right. And so we have this idea, perhaps, of Jesus trying to placate the wrath of God. How tragic it is that people, and especially children, aren't told over and over again, as Jesus said, the Father himself loves you. The Father himself loves you. We must never forget that, as Paul says, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Of course, we all know in John 3:16, it was the Father who gave his only son that we might not perish but have everlasting life. It was because God loved the world that he gave his son. He did not give his son in order to learn to love the world, but because he already loved the world. If God be for us, what does Romans 8:31 say? Who or what can be against us? Never forget, friends, God the Father is on your side. He wants you to succeed. He wants you to be victorious. He is not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to repentance. That's the God that we serve. And then there are those who believe that the whole idea of facing God in the judgment detracts from the assurance of salvation. Let me explain why. If we have to wait for the results of the judgment, in some people's minds, that causes uncertainty about their standing before God. Well, God isn't finished yet, so I'm not sure if maybe at the last minute, God's going to find something, some unforgiven sin, and that's going to keep me out of heaven. Those of you that were here when I was here noted that one of my burdens was preaching on the subject of the assurance of salvation. Because for the typical Seventh-day Adventist, they do not have that assurance. Why? Because we have, in many cases, overreacted against the doctrine of once saved, always saved. All you have to do is give your life to Jesus at some point, and no matter what you do from that point on, you're automatically going to make it, no matter what you do. And then so, you know, you ask the typical Adventist, do you know you're saved? Do you know if Jesus were to come today, you would be in the kingdom with him? And we often say, well, I hope I'm saved. I wish I would be saved, or whatever. You know, there's a wonderful hymn in the hymnal, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I once preached a sermon entitled, Whatever Happened to Blessed Assurance? Before I'm finished this morning, I want you to see, hope you will see, that properly understood, the judgment is good news, not bad news. And so we'll work toward that in just a moment. But for most people, the idea of judgment is full of negative overtones. And one reason is because our modern system of justice tends to look at the judgment process only in terms of conviction or acquittal. But you see, judges in Bible times were not only concerned with convicting criminals, but listen carefully, also vindicating the righteous in a very positive way. We're going to look at a couple of scriptures right now, and then I'm going to quote some others because of time, about how the ancients thought about the judgment. Would you turn with me to Psalm chapter 43? By the way, this is a subject that's been burning on my heart for years. I've never preached this sermon before. It's brand new, hot off the press, so to speak. And my heart is just full to overflowing today with this message. Psalm 43 and verse 1. Yeah, 43, not 23, the shepherd's psalm, but 43, verse 1. Notice what David says. This may seem like a surprise to you, and I'll explain why in just a minute. He's praying out to God. He's pleading. This is what he says. Judge me, O God. I want you to judge me. And notice he says, and plead my cause. So there's a little clue right there, right? I want you to judge me. Stand up for me, God. Plead my cause against an ungodly nation. David here is using courtroom language. And he's crying out to God, number one, asking him to be his judge, to examine his life, and then also to be his defense counsel, to defend him against an ungodly nation that was threatening the security of Israel. David utters a similar plea in Psalm chapter 35, where he adds an additional reason why he wants God to judge or vindicate him. And by the way, in both the NIV and the New King James Version, instead of saying, judge me, O God, it says, vindicate me, O God. So let's look at Psalm 35 and verse 24. And here he has an additional reason for asking God to judge him. Judge me or vindicate me, O Lord my God. Now why? According to what? Thy righteousness. And let not them, the wicked, rejoice over me. Here's a second reason why David wanted God to judge him. Not only to plead his cause, but because God is a righteous and a just God. One who is perfectly fair. And sometimes when I've conducted funeral services for those who were not known to be practicing Christians, and maybe just the opposite, or perhaps committed suicide or something else, or died suddenly and didn't have a time to get their life in order with God. You know, the family are always concerned about their destiny, but I always remind them, God is a fair and a merciful God, and He will do the right thing. You don't need to worry about the salvation of your loved one. That doesn't mean everybody's going to be saved. I'm not saying that. But God will make the right decision, and you can safely entrust the destiny of your loved one to God. So let Him handle that. God wants people to be saved even more than you do. So leave it up to God. And so He says, our God is, my God is a righteous God. And He will impartially weigh our conduct and our motives. Because David knew God to be a fair and righteous judge, he's repeatedly urging his readers to praise God for being such a wonderful judge. Let me just share a couple of scriptures. You can write the references down because I'm going to go through these quickly, these next couple of texts. Psalm 67 in verse 4. David exclaimed, let the nations be glad and rejoice and sing for joy, for you shall judge the nations righteously. He says, be happy. Sing for joy. And then in Psalm 98, verses 8 and 9, he says, let the rivers clap their hands. Let the hills be joyful together before the Lord. For He is coming to judge the world. With righteousness He shall judge the world and the people with fairness. Amen. Let me read another one in this regard here about praising God because He's the judge. And by the way, Aren't you glad that he's the judge and not one of your fellow church members? I think God is going to be easier on us and we're going to be on ourselves, right? I've often said that. I'm glad, you know, we're not the judge of each other. God's the judge. And he's the best kind of a judge. And so in Psalm 96, verses 9 to 13. The first verse is one that we've often heard, and I'm going to share it with you in the King James, and then I'm going to tell you the rest of it I'll read in the Living Bible paraphrase. It says in the King James, "Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." And I often, you know, I've heard that, and it's even in some songs, and I've often thought about that scripture. And, you know, it conjures up the idea that we're the house of God that we worship in should be beautiful. And this is a very beautiful church. In fact, I have pastored churches all over the country, on the East Coast, the Midwest, Southern California, everywhere. And I've done evangelistic meetings around the world. This is one of the most beautiful churches I've ever pastored in. The lovely church. But that isn't what it's talking about here, praising God in a beautiful sanctuary, and in a sanctuary that is beautiful to behold. The way the Living Bible puts it captures the real intent of this verse in the Hebrew, and that is, worship the Lord, now listen, with the beauty of holy lives. The way that we're to worship God is with holiness, a life. Not just when we come to Sabbath for a few hours in church for a few hours on Sabbath morning, but all our whole life. 1 Corinthians 10:32, whatever you eat, drink, or do, do all to the glory of God. And so how do we worship God? The best kind of worship, in addition to our words, is to let our lives be a testimony of God's grace working in us. The beauty of holy lives. David goes on to say here, tell the nations that Jehovah reigns. He rules the world. His power can never be overthrown. He will judge all nations fairly. Let the heavens be glad, the earth rejoice. Let the vastness of the roaring seas demonstrate his glory. Praise him for the growing fields, for they display his greatness. Let the trees of the forest rustle with praise. Why? For the Lord is coming to judge the earth. And then the punchline, he will judge the nations fairly and with truth. Amen. Wow. Now, let me share with you, while as I'm talking, turn to Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 to 12. We're not going to read all of those, just one little part there. But this is a passage that is probably one of the key texts of Seventh-day Adventists. We commonly refer to this passage as the three angels' messages. But I want to share with you this morning that the angels that John is talking about here in Revelation 14 are human messengers, not heavenly beings. Because you see the word angel, angelos, in the Greek literally means a messenger. It can be a human messenger or it can be a divine messenger. So even though you may not know it and your spouse or children may not think that, you are angels. If you are, in fact, sharing the good news, because God has commissioned us to share this message with the world. But guess what? He did not command the angels to preach the gospel to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, but to us. And so we're the angels that are being referred to here in Revelation 14. Now look at verse 6. It begins this passage, and I want to concentrate on the first part of verse 7. And so it says, "And I saw another angel or messenger fly in the midst of heaven," that means swiftly throughout the world, "having the everlasting gospel to preach to them who dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice," so that everyone will take notice and hear, "fear or reverence God and give glory to him." Why? "For the hour of his judgment has come." Now notice here that the judgment hour message is part of the everlasting gospel. And what does the gospel mean? Good news. It comes from the Greek word evangelion, from which we get our word evangelism. You see, some people want to limit the gospel to what Jesus accomplished on the cross. But if everything that was necessary for man's salvation was accomplished on Calvary, why are we still here 2,000 years later? If Jesus did everything he ever needed to do on Calvary, why are we still here, and why is there still sin and death? You see, the gospel, my friends, includes the totality of Jesus' saving work for mankind. And it includes his present-day ministry for us, as it's made clear in Hebrews chapter 7. This is the verse we're going to look at, so if you'll turn there, Hebrews chapter 7, is the verse that we have read many, many times. And yet, most of us have failed to grasp its true significance. Hebrews, by the way, is just before James, 1 and 2 Peter, and the three Johns. I want to help you locate that there. Hebrews chapter 7, because I want you to see it and mark it in your own Bible. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Wherefore, or therefore, he, Jesus, is able, and what's the, to do what? What's the next word? To save. Underscore that. Jesus is able to save. And before I go on there, you know, people, didn't Jesus save us on Calvary? We'll just hold that thought there. Jesus is able to save them to the uttermost, that means completely and wholly, that come unto God by him, seeing that he, or because, why is he able to save? Because he ever lives. Because he ever lives to make intercession for us. Now that's quite a statement. Let's just think about that for a moment. According to this verse, the intercession of Christ in our behalf in the sanctuary above is just as essential to the plan of salvation as was his death on Calvary. Or to put it another way, the cross did not end the plan of salvation. It only began it. God's last day messenger expressed it this way in Great Controversy, page 489, quote, by his death, Jesus began that work which after his resurrection he ascended to complete in heaven. See, most Christians today, and I'm going to have to leave out some statements here, several of them, in fact, but they believe that the atonement was completed at the cross. Now, let me say this. Jesus made a complete sacrifice on the cross, but the atonement, because it's never going to be repeated again, once and for all, Paul says over and over again in Hebrews. But, you see, in the earthly sanctuary for atonement / reconciliation to be complete, two things were necessary. There had to be a sacrifice, and there had to be a priest who administered the blood of the sacrifice. So in just a couple of minutes, till I get to the real punchline of my message today, just to review what happened. Every day, the sinner, if he was living near the temple, would bring a sacrificial animal. He'd place his hands over the head of it, confess his sins, and symbolically the sin was transferred from it to the animal. And because it was his sin, and the Bible says the wages of sin is death, he had to cut the throat of that animal and kill it. Wasn't a very pleasant thing. And sin is not a very pleasant thing. And then the priest would be standing by with the basin. He would catch that blood. And he would go into the sanctuary and he would sprinkle it on the curtain dividing the two apartments. Every drop of blood that was sprinkled on that curtain was a sin, as it were, that was written down, a record made in blood testifying to the sins of God's people. That went on every day. Once a year, there was a very special service. On the 10th day of the 7th month, the Day of Atonement, Two goats were chosen, one to represent the Lord Jesus Christ and the other Satan. Over the Lord's goat, there were no hands of confession placed because Jesus knew no sin. He was holy, harmless, and undefiled. But that goat representing the Lord, it was killed. And its blood was taken into the sanctuary and was sprinkled over the dried blood that accumulated there all year long. And the pure blood of Jesus brought not only forgiveness now, they were forgiven when the sins went into the sanctuary every day. They were forgiven. But the record was still written down there in blood. But on the Day of Atonement, the blood of Jesus from the Lord's goat was placed over the blood representing the sins of the people. And 1 John 1:7 says, the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. The very record of sin was blotted out. It was covered as if I had a whiteboard up here and I'd written down some sins here. And then I get an eraser and I wipe out the whiteboard. That's what happened on the Day of Atonement. And it was not until the Day of Atonement that atonement for mankind was complete. And so when Jesus died on Calvary, he was our sacrificial lamb. That was the first phase of the atonement. And then when Jesus ascended to heaven, he began working on the second phase, the mediatorial phase. Now, let me ask a simple question. You're going to say, Pastor, are you insulting my intelligence? No, but I want to make a point here. Who did Jesus die for on the cross? Did he die for everybody? Did he die for everybody? It's a simple question, not a trick question. Yes, he did. Okay, so if Jesus died for everybody, does that mean then that everybody's going to be saved? You see, some people draw that conclusion because he died for everybody. On Calvary, now listen carefully to these next couple of points. On Calvary, Jesus made, when he shed his blood, he made provision for everybody to be saved. But it is only those who accept him by faith in his wonderful free gift of salvation that in heaven as our high priest, he sprinkles the blood, as it were, symbolically to our record books in heaven. So the blood was shed on Calvary, it sprinkled in heaven, and through that, only those who accept Jesus as their personal Savior, even though he made provision at Calvary, will have his blood credited to their account. And so both of these were necessary for salvation and atonement to be complete. I'm going to skip out another section here. So in the remaining few moments here, I'd like to share with you, in addition to what I've already said, why I believe, properly understood, that judgment is indeed good news. First of all, it's because Jesus, as our high priest, intercedes for us before the Father in heaven. Now, here's an interesting thought. You may have not have thought of it this way before, and I hadn't either until this week. On the ancient Day of Atonement, everyone in Israel passed in review before God. We know that part. But here's the point. The people didn't have to stand in line one by one to go into the sanctuary to be judged one by one. It wasn't, you know, take a number and stand in line, and each one of the children of Israel are going to go into the sanctuary. Now listen, this is amazing. Instead, they all entered together by faith in the person of a single person, the high priest. He was their stand-in, their proxy, their representative. He's going in behalf of and in place of them. Not like some modern lawyer who argues and pleads trying to convince the judge of a person's innocence. But rather, the high priest is taking the people's place, identifying with them and pleading their cause and bearing their guilt. So in one person, the high priest, instead of the individual having to come in there. The high priest is representing him. Friend, Jesus is representing us before the Father. We don't literally, we see these paintings, and you know, how else can you explain it? But you see these paintings in our books, you know, again, like I said earlier, Jesus standing with his arm around us in the judgment of the Father, they're sitting on the throne. We're not physically going to appear in the judgment. Our names will appear in the judgment, our record, but Jesus is going to be there representing us as our high priest, as our intercessor. By the way, before we look at a closing verse here in just a couple of minutes, I want you to turn to a text. And somebody want, it's in Exodus, so you can turn to Exodus 28. What does the priestly ministry of Jesus have to do with the judgment? And this is a verse I came across this week. I've read it before, but it never clicked. And it's Exodus 28. Exodus 28, verses 29 and 30. It's a very interesting verse. I want to give you time to actually look it up and mark it in your Bible. I doubt it that you've ever read it either. Exodus 28, beginning with verse 29. Now, you've read it, but maybe the light hasn't gone on in your mind. It says, "So Aaron shall bear the names of the sons of Israel." Now, notice, on the breastplate. Now, we know that, you know, they had the precious stones in the breastplate, but look at the expression. On the breastplate of judgment, over his heart, when he goes into the sanctuary as a memorial before the Lord perpetually. And you shall put in the breastplate of judgment the Urim and the Thummim, and they shall be over Aaron's heart when he goes in before the Lord. So Aaron shall bear the judgment of the children of Israel over his heart before the Lord continually. The breastplate contained the names of the 12 tribes of Israel, and it signified the closeness of the intercessor to his people. Symbolically, he's bearing them on his heart. So the priest, because of the breastplate, is serving in a due role as priest, as representative, as judge. He's wearing the breastplate of judgment. And the Bible says in the same way, Jesus ever lives to make intercession for us. And he has graven our names on the palms of his hands. So one reason why why the judgment is good news, Jesus is interceding for us in heaven. But more than that, Jesus is also defending us against the accusations of Satan. 1 John 2:1 says, "If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous." Now, an advocate is one who speaks in behalf of another and comes to his defense. When a person is summoned to appear in court, he hires an advocate or a defense attorney to stand in his place and plead his cause. Now, it's kind of related to the intercessor, so I'm waiting now to make the point for both here. Why does Jesus need to plead as our intercessor and our advocate in heaven? Is it to change the mind of an angry or a reluctant God? Like the parable of the persistent widow kept on knocking on the door of the judge, you know, and eventually, you know, Jesus pleads long enough and the Father says, "All right, then I give up, you win." Is that why Jesus is serving as our intercessor and defense attorney? No. Rather, my friends, it is to silence the accusations of Satan. Now, I love the bulletin cover that Kathy picked out this week, and she picked out two, and she sent them to my secretary, and this is amazing. I've never seen this picture before, this artwork. You might want to take a look at that. You know, you've got that old devil right there, you know, just pointing out all the sins, like Joshua the high priest, you know, and that poor sinner there. And the devil, boy, he knows what we have done, and he's spilling the beans on us. He's accusing us. Revelation 12 says he is the accuser of the brethren. And that Jesus is there defending that individual against the accusations of Jesus. Satan is the prosecuting attorney. Jesus is the defense attorney. But I've got more good news. So not only is Jesus our intercessor, he's representing us in our behalf as our high priest. Not only is he our defense attorney, but it even gets better. Turn with me for our last text to John chapter 5. The Gospel of John. Boy, I could just preach all day on this subject. John chapter 5, first of all, verse 22. Oh, how I love these next few verses. It just keeps getting better and better. 1 John 5, verse 22. For the Father judges no man. Aha. You ask the average person on the street today, or even the average Christian, who's the judge? God. God who? God the Father. Now notice. For the Father judges no man, but has committed all judgment to who? To the Son. So who's the judge? Jesus. I'm not done yet. Let's go down to verse 26. And Jesus is speaking, for as the Father has life in himself, so he has given permission for the Son to have life in himself, and has given him authority to execute or carry out judgment. Why? Why has God the Father asked Jesus to be the judge, not himself? Notice the last phrase in verse 27. Because he, Jesus, is what? The Son of Man. Now, what does that suggest to you? Because Jesus took on humanity. That's what the incarnation, that's what the Christmas story is all about. God became flesh and dwelt among us. He's been there. He was subjected to trials and temptations, discouragement, and everything that the devil could throw at him. That's why we had in our scripture reading a sympathizing high priest who identifies with us. He's experienced what we've experienced. He's going to be a merciful and understanding high priest. He knows that. David says he understands our frame. He knows that we are dust. And so the one who is going to decide our ultimate destiny is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. Now let me put the package all together. And if this doesn't get you excited, nothing will. I want you to think of this. The same person, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our Creator, and not only our Creator, but our Redeemer, is also our defense attorney and our judge, all in one. You talk about a winning combination. The one who made you. So you think if you make something with your hands, that's kind of special to you? He not only made you, but when you got lost and ruined and broken by sin, he says, I'm going to put you back together again. I'm going to make you whole. I'm going to restore you. I'm going to redeem you. You are precious in my sight. And because you are precious, I have a twofold vested interest. I made you. I bought you. You are mine. I'm going to stand up before you in the judgment. And not only am I going to stand up for you and tell Satan, get out of here. You don't know what you're talking about. You know, their sins are forgiven. There's nothing. There's no record against them. And then he says, I am going to pass the verdict. He does all of this. Isn't that exciting? That's the kind of God that we serve. That's what Jesus, and most of the Christian world doesn't have a clue as to why the ministry of Jesus in the heavenly sanctuary is so important. The sanctuary message is one of the unique doctrines of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. No other church, period, teaches the full implications of the sanctuary message and what Jesus is doing today. Remember Matthew 10:32? Jesus said, whoever confesses me before men or acknowledge, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. Friends, today, it's our relationship to Jesus Christ that makes all the difference. Is your life hid with God in Christ Jesus, as Paul said? Are you abiding in him and trusting in him and him alone for your salvation? If so, you can face the judgment with perfect confidence. As we're told in 1 John 4, you can just write it down. You can read it later. 1 John 4, verses 16 and 17. And this is the assurance that we have before God, John says. 1 John 4, 16 and 17. The test in the judgment is not whether you and I are worthy to be saved. For we will never reach the place in our Christian experience where God is going to be obligated to save us because of our achievements. What matters, my friend, is Christ's merits, his righteousness, not our own. And if we accept him as our Savior, repent of our sins, and trust in his perfect sinless life is credited to us, and we stand before God just as if we had never sinned. Hallelujah. Nothing against us. And so as we conclude this morning, I just feel on the basis of this sermon, it's going to be very, very quick, but I've got to just ask you to respond. And before you do, let me just explain what the appeal is. Would you like to say this morning, I want to place my life, whether you've done it before, but I'm already standing, so I can't stand again, but I'll wave my hands or something. But I want to rededicate my life. I want to say, I want my life to be totally in God's hands, Jesus' hands. I understand from today's message that he is interceding before me, before those who have entrusted the keeping of their lives to him. And I want Jesus to cover me with his robe of righteousness and to present me faultless before the Father and before the onlooking universe. If you want to join me in that response, saying, here am I, Lord, I want to be fully yours. I want you to be my advocate, my intercessor, my high priest, my defense attorney, my judge. I want you to do all of that for me. Won't you just tell Jesus how much you love him this morning? Just stand to your feet and say, thank you, Lord, that you are willing to do all of this for me. For me. Praise God. Let's pray. Oh, God, my heart has been stirred this morning as I've shared this message. It has just come home to me with fresh newness to think of all that you have done and continue to do for us. I thank you that after Calvary, you just didn't sit on, you know, in heaven, twiddling your thumbs, doing absolutely nothing. You have been intimately involved with each one of us, not only preparing a place, but more importantly, preparing us to dwell in that place. Thank you, Lord, for all that you are doing for us now. And help us to be fully surrendered and committed to you. Help us to be free in our expression of love to you and our acknowledgement to those around us, those that we meet, that Jesus is our best friend. We love him. We're not ashamed of Jesus and his gospel. Lord, when you come again and that day is drawing near, I pray that each person in this room and those who are watching online and who will maybe hear this through a CD, we will all be among those blessed people who will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air and to be able to personally tell him how much we appreciate what he's done. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Very quickly, would you take your hymnals and turn? I know we're a few minutes late, but I want you to sing this song. That's 179. And pay attention to these words. They are really, this is going to be your vocal response to today's message. Thank you.
Thoughts exceed the Son of
Aren't those marvelous words? Oh, man, I mean, you can't say it any better than that. You'll notice it was written by Raymond F. Cottrell, whole series of Cottrells that have served our denomination for generations. He was one of the early editors back in the days about the same time of Uriah Smith that was an editor of the Review and Herald. And this particular melody was, words was put to music by an Adventist composer, Perry Beach, who used to live down the street when we lived in La Sierra. And you'll notice the tune of this melody is called La Sierra. So this is a good Adventist hymn. Well, we've all already had our prayer, so I'm just going to give you a benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he watch over you until we meet again. Amen.